Today's podcast is brought to you by FreshBooks.com. Get a 30-day free trial at GoFreshBooks.com/David Feldman Show.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Joining us is our resident film critic, Michael Snyder. These are the movies he's going to discuss with us today. Sully, Kicks, Author, the J.T. Leroy story, For the Love of Spock and Demon. How are you, Mr. Snyder?
I'm good, Mr. Feldman. How are you doing? How's New York City?
It's, you know, hot and muggy. Were you in Los Angeles?
I am indeed splitting my time between L.A. and San Francisco, as usual.
How the Giants doing this year?
They are a half game in front in the wild card race over the New York Mets at the moment. So it's excitement plus.
And we're going to be saying goodbye to Vin Scully this year.
You know, the young man from New Orleans, Louisiana. I'm not even going to do a Vin Scully impression. Vin Scully is an institution out here in Los Angeles, and it's never more clear than when you're driving near Dodger Stadium and see the road signs for Vin Scully Boulevard or Way or Avenue, whatever it is. They adore the man here, and he is kind of a local institution.
You know, I'm not a sports fan, but I do remember Groucho saying the one thing that keeps him going in his dotage is Vin Scully. As far back as the 70s, Groucho said that the only thing that makes life worth living is listening to Vin Scully doing play-by-play for the Dodgers. He goes all the way back to Jackie Robinson.
Yeah. I mean, he's the only thing I don't hate about the Dodgers, actually, as a Giants fan.
Does it matter that why does he have to say goodbye? I mean, do you have to be that good? Who, Harry Carey got everything wrong, but people didn't care, right?
Well, actually, he's a little sharper than Harry Carey.
Yeah, I know. Does anybody really care that Vin Scully does he make mistakes? I don't listen.
Well, you know, the biggest mistake he makes is doing play-by-play for the hated Dodgers in my book. But he's got such a soothing voice. I mean, even driving down the freeways here in Los Angeles and switching on a Dodger game just to find out if they're losing or not, for a guy like me, a Giants fan, there's still that wonderful cadence of Vin Scully. I hate to say it, but it's true.
Well, I have to find, we have Carlos Alzeraqui doing a Vin Scully impersonation for the radio show. I think we did it like 3 or 4 years ago. I got to find it. We had some sketch. Ben Zelovansky wrote it. For some reason the Dodgers were cutting back. The previous owners were getting a divorce, and we did this whole sketch about how the Dodgers were trying to save money, and we have a Vin Scully impersonation. Can we find that, Alex?
Hey, who would get custody of Vin in the divorce? That would have been the question, right?
Yeah. There was a couple that owned the Dodgers before Magic, right?
Horrible, horrible people. Incidentally, anybody affiliated with the Dodgers but Vin Scully, in my mind, is a horrible, horrible person.
And do you mean that? I mean, I'm a grown-up. I'm no longer a kid.
Huh.
And are you being cute when you say that? Or do you actually hate the Dodgers, in all honesty?
I do. It's the most heated rivalry in sports. And as a Giants fan, I bleed orange and black
But you're a grown man. I mean, you're just making an arbitrary decision that you love the Giants and hate the Dodgers. I mean,
No. The Dodgers actually plan crimes. They abuse babies. The Dodgers are not nice people, seriously.
But this is just grown men doing their Michael Jackson, Peter Pan act.
Are you talking about me again? But the truth of the matter is that,
yeah, but
you're
just deciding that you hate the Dodgers for no reason other than you want to be 8 years old again.
No. I love the Giants organization.
Why?
I admire the
way
they play.
Why would you love them?
They play with spirit and heart. They always have top-notch you know, quality people on the team. They are very, very different in each individual player, but they play with cohesion. The manager, Bruce Bochy, is one of the finest minds in the sport. It's appreciating the sport for what it is, and it's embracing a rivalry that's been literally over a century long. And you got to love that.
All right. It's a character flaw. I have a character flaw.
No, let me tell you something. I went to Dodger Stadium to see the Giants play on the Giants' dime. Management provided me and a couple other people with tickets. I used to write for Giants Magazine. I have a real connection to the Giants franchise. And one of the things I did with the access I had was to go into the club level. And let me tell you this. Even though people have an affection for Dodger Stadium, yeah, there are broken cup holders. So don't get too hoity-toity, guys. Yet on the club level, on that corridor that circles the stadium, is a Dodgers museum, a collection of memorabilia going back to the 1800s. And I thought it was absolutely great. It's the first time I've ever said anything like, oh, my God, this is of great value, and it's connected to the Dodgers. I want to say quickly that one of the most delightful aspects of things, other than learning that the team changed its handle from the Brooklyn Baseball Club to the Brooklyn Bridegrooms to the Brooklyn Superbas to the Brooklyn Robins, the Brooklyn Dodgers finally, and of course the Los Angeles Dodgers, was to be reminded that they had not won a World Series in decades and decades, and their fans in Brooklyn were so embittered that they tagged them with the name Bums, Dem Bums, the Brooklyn Bums. And oh my God, in the 50s, the franchise decided to own it, and their mascot on all of their schedules and yearbooks was a filthy-looking hobo.
Really?
And yes, and I totally love it. This guy, you're looking at this image on the smirking hobo with a cigar and ripped up clothes. You could almost smell him off the cover of the yearbook. And I just thought that was completely hilarious. And I kind of wish it had been extended to their Los Angeles tenure. But alas, no. Nonetheless, kudos to the Dodgers organization. Right. You heard me say that, for their wonderful in-house museum, which features relics from Ebbets Field and stuff from, again, the previous 100 plus years of Dodger history. Like, wow.
And where do they get the name Dodgers from? Do you know?
I believe that they changed from the Robins to the Dodgers because of the trolleys that surrounded Ebbets Field, the Dodgers' home stadium in Brooklyn. And I think it was meant to mean the trolley Dodgers.
Nope. Rush yep. Limbaugh, Dick Cheney, George W. Bush, and Donald Trump all played for them, and they were draft Dodgers.
Oh yeah, the draft Dodgers. That was also possibly it in the 60s. No, it was the trolleys. The trolleys were treacherous. To be a fan, you had to be able to dodge them. I think that's the origin of the name.
I think you're right. It's interesting how hobos, at one time in this country, it was perceived that, I guess, being a hobo was almost romantic, right?
Well, this guy looks pretty filthy on the Dodger programs.
But I mean, being a hobo is considered a choice.
Well, there's a certain romance to it. You know, the romance of the road, you know, carrying a stick over your shoulder with the, you know, a kerchief and all your belongings stuffed into the kerchief. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Can't get enough of that.
So in 2009, the country was falling apart. We had a new president. He had just been inaugurated. And I remember this. I remember they used to say that Ronald Reagan was lucky. And you need a lucky president for the country to turn around. And I remember thinking George W. Bush was unlucky. Maybe we'll have some luck with Barack Obama. And shortly into his presidency, I don't know the exact date, but I remember this vividly. The stock market had collapsed. We were losing a million jobs a month. There was no faith in our economic system. We had this young, inexperienced president, but maybe he was going to be lucky. And I remember there were pirates off the coast of Somalia And very early in his presidency, Barack Obama sent the SEALs in, and they killed the pirates and freed the merchant marines. And I remember thinking, ah, he's lucky. The sun is shining on Barack Obama the way it did with Ronald Reagan, the way it didn't with Jimmy Carter, who tried to rescue the hostages and failed in Iran. And then I remember Sully Sullenberger landing his plane on the Hudson River and everybody living and surviving, and it was a hero, and the Obama administration was new. And I remember thinking, this we have a real hero who embodies this new generation that Barack Obama is going to bring in. I find it curious that the movie Sully comes out at the very end of the Obama administration. Tom Hanks and I are often on the same page when it comes to history. I haven't seen the movie. But is it tied into the Obama administration and how we need heroes and good luck and good fortune?
There is no specific connection to the president in the movie, other than the fact that this happened at a time when, you are correct, the country needed a bit of a boost. It's telling that the director of this movie is acknowledged Republican, Clint Eastwood.
Who makes one bad movie after another. Everything, he makes great elevator pitches. Like you think, oh, Tom Hanks and in Sully, as Sully, it's directed by Clint Eastwood. That has to be great. And then you go see it and you go, all right, Clint Eastwood's an idiot.
No.
Eastwood, his movies suck.
This is a much better movie in my mind than the jingoistic American Sniper, if that's what you want to hear. This is an old guy directing a docudrama about another old guy, and he came up with a damn good film. And the story is inspiring, and it's also a story of a guy whose competence level is very high, but an unassuming guy. You know, we love our heroes to be self-effacing. We love them to go, hey, just doing my job, ma'am. And that's Chesley Sully Sullenberger, the guy who somehow made an emergency water landing on the Hudson in the heart of the New York City Metroplex with over 150 people inside the plane. And, you know, Clint, his movies can be pedestrian. They can be good. This is one of the good ones. And Tom Hanks is just dandy as Sully. This guy is a quietly efficient, thoughtful man who does his job to the best of his skills. And after all this happened, he was a totally unwilling celebrity in the wake of, what do they call it, the miracle on the Hudson, right? And,
in fact,
you know,
he used his celebrity to testify before Congress on the dangers of pilots being overworked and underpaid. Is that talked about in the movie?
Well, this is interesting. What's really good about this film is that this guy, truly with the right stuff, was targeted of what was probably an insurance-driven investigation of the landing, despite the fact that it was clearly total engine failure because a bunch of birds slammed into the plane's engines. And these officials are questioning whether ditching the plane was necessary.
Was this in the movie?
Oh, yes, it is.
Well, what about
needless endangerment?
What about, his being in Miami, stooping a stewardess, doing all that cocaine, mixing vodka and orange juice in the cockpit?
No, that's not in the movie. That's in your movie.
Oh, that's the Denzel movie. Washington movie.
Yeah, that's a different film entirely.
What was that movie called?
Drunk Pilot?
Flight? Yeah. What was it called?
More like Crash.
Where he flies the plane upside down. And
Yeah, great. Flight. Listen, let me tell you something. This is probably very close to taking transcripts, and it certainly, when the screenwriter did this, they clearly must have spoken to and interviewed Sully, his co-pilot Jeff Skiles, his wife Lori. It's pretty straight up.
And what about the geese?
The geese were portrayed by animatronics, and they were very, very upset that they were made to be the villains in this thing.
How many geese did he kill?
He slaughtered a bunch of them, and PETA is protesting outside his house right now.
Disgraceful.
Actually,
he's a murderer.
Actually,
he's a butcher.
Really, the truth is they're delicious when properly prepared. Right. Aaron Eckhart plays the co-pilot. You know, it's interesting. We know what happened, but Eastwood and his crew do a spot-on recreation of this incident, and the tension over the hearings into Sully's handling of the crisis and his personal life and how it's being impacted by the attention. And there's even a sequence. By the way, I watched it in IMAX, and it's a great You Are There way to appreciate this film for what it is. There's a sequence where they're all on Letterman, you know, and it's before anything's been settled with the investigation. And, of course, the technology is such that they were able to put the five actors playing Sully, his co-pilot, and the three flight attendants onto the Letterman stage with Letterman and interacting. So it's Tom Hanks on Letterman yet again. Tom Hanks is actually very good in this, and there's a good supporting cast. Laura Linney as the wife, again, Aaron Eckhart as the co-pilot, and various other actors. You know, one thing I want to point out before we move on is with the white hair and the trimmed little mustache, I think Hanks is now a natural for the inevitable Gail Gordon biopic.
Tell everybody who Gail Gordon is, please.
It was Lucille Ball's foil in her show.
Mr. Mooney.
Also, maybe the Gerald McRaney biopic. Or, okay, are you ready for this? Monopoly the movie, portraying the Monopoly man. I mean, Hanks is quite good in this film. And I walked away from the film feeling this was a solid entertainment, gave us insight into something that we all know about from the newspapers. I thought it was good.
Yeah, you know, I've always heard, in case of a water landing, there's never a water landing.
There was here.
Was he showboating?
Not in the least. The investigation reveals that he made a decision brought on by circumstance. He was agreed with by his co-pilot, and it really did. It was the only way to save the flight and the people. Any attempts to go back to LaGuardia, which is what they were kind of contesting, that would have been a good idea. They ran all these simulations and stuff, would have resulted in a crash. And in a tightly populated metropolitan area like New York, who the hell knows who else would have been collateral damage?
Nah. I think he could have brought it back.
Sure. Why don't you watch the movie and decide for yourself?
I think, what are they going to do? Who benefits if they say, why, if they do an investigation and he's not a hero?
The insurance company.
How much?
Oh, millions.
How much?
Millions, I'm sure.
Okay, but you know, how many more millions does everybody make if we have a hero?
Well, we do. But
we've decided he's a hero.
Yeah, but they still lost the plane. You know, there was all the rescue work.
Okay, let me ask you a question.
Okay.
By the way, I love Sully Sullenberger. I agree, you know, it was fantastic. But there's no way that plane lands in the water. He becomes a hero. Everybody lives. And they're going to look into him and say, you screwed up.
They were going to actually castigate him. I think that's all on the record, if in fact it turned out that he was not right in his decision. And it was that's basically the heart of the film.
I believe the investigation had to be slanted in his favor.
Well, at first it seems like it's not in the movie, but maybe this is all, you know, fictionalized, but for whatever purpose, you know, you can be the skeptic that I know you are. That's fine.
But I don't like you demonizing the insurance industry. I mean, these people, these are good people, and it's not fair. I mean, they've given us Obamacare, and all my dealings with the insurance industry have been upright, and it's not about money. It's providing safety and security. So I just think it's a cheap, easy target to go after.
Yeah,
you
know, like big pharma, yeah. Those guys, they're the best.
It's so easy to demonize the insurance people. He could have landed the plane on the tarmac at Newark Airport safely. He was showboating. He wanted to do a water landing because he wanted, you know, He wanted a book. He wanted to be a hero. We all want to be a hero. So I'm going to land it in the water.
Well, I will say this. While he's landing the plane on the Hudson, he is speaking to an agent on his cell phone. So maybe you're right. Maybe you're right. I don't know.
All right. So I should go see this?
Yeah, you know, I think you should. You should probably see it in a nice theater with big whatever. And you'll walk away complaining about Clint Eastwood and his jingoistic attitudes.
Nice.
So, yeah. Look, it's a solid entertainment. It really is.
The only Clint Eastwood movie I loved recently was Million Dollar Baby.
Well, this is maybe his best film since then. How's that grab you?
Does it have an uplifting ending as Million Dollar Baby? I mean, that ending, I was just like exhilarated for a month after seeing the ending of Million Dollar Baby.
I bet you were.
Kicks.
Kicks is really kind of a little marvel. It's a very creatively rendered coming-of-age story, which is set in the San Francisco Bay Area, in the East Bay, and specifically the economically depressed
the
inner
East
city
Bay,
neighborhood.
Excuse me, the East Bay, or as Sully Sullenberger calls that, Runway 2.
Yeah, right. Very nice. You don't want him hitting the inner city neighborhoods of Richmond and Oakland, which are rough areas. And this movie is tough, but it's pretty tender, and it's made with a lot of compassion and excitement and a modicum of wit by the director and co-screenwriter, Justin Tipping, who was born and raised in Oakland, so he knows the turf. So it's all about this 15-year-old kid named Brandon, and Brandon is played by a very impressive newcomer named Jaquin Guillory. And this kid pools together all his money working and doing odd jobs and such because he wants to buy really expensive sneakers and impress his peers and impress a girl he likes and get a little swagger because he's a little guy and he's sort of bullied by people. So anyway, he does this. He gets the sneakers from a hustler, and shortly thereafter, a local thug steals the sneakers from him, abuses him. It's all on YouTube. And this essentially decent kid, you know, takes the fall. So now his thing is, I've been humiliated. I'm getting the sneakers back. By the way, kicks is in the patois a euphemism for the sneakers. So these are expensive, you know, like Michael Jordan-y sneakers, right? You remember back in the day, Air Jordans were like a whole deal. You know, you used to have reasonably priced canvas sneakers, and then you have an expensive, highly prized, celebrity-endorsed athletic shoes, starting in the mid-'80s, I think, with Air Jordans. And the footwear was so valuable that it became the target of theft and violence. I mean, I remember news stories about this stuff.
And, well, sneakers have become collector's items. I mean, they're investments now.
Well, this is great. So the challenge is holding on to the shoes when you have them, mm-hmm. when you're a kid in the hood. So we see the kid and his two best friends who become companions on his quest. And this is right out of the hero's journey. And they learn hard lessons about growing up in a disadvantaged, dangerous realm, about the burden of loyalty, about the cost of coveting possessions at the expense of your own well-being. Because things get really, really rough. But the kid is determined, and that's kind of hopeful in a way. And they've got, like, hip-hop recordings, old school and new school, and, like, little kind of brief quotes from various tracks in on-screen text to kind of reflect and comment on the kid's mission. And that's a little distracting, but it kind of gives you a breather as the movie goes from chapter to chapter. And, you know, one of the better things about the film is its sense of place and its depiction of, like, what are basically singular cultural elements. There is a sideshow. Do you know what a sideshow is, David?
It, on a like a carnival has like a little thing off to the side.
It's a gathering of locals and their friends with tricked out cars in a street ritual of what amounts to fancy driving. So people are like doing figure eights and circles with the doors open, driving as they like hang outside the thing. It's like this sort of. It is kind of a carnival. And so there's a sideshow where a lot of the action happens. And the kid is going after his adversary who took the shoes. And you find out that this guy's pretty cruel, kind of a, you know, kind of a alpha male. But when he gets to his home, he gives the shoes he's stolen with love and care to his little prepubescent son. So it's shaded in gray. And our hero, Brandon, goes to see his uncle, who is sort of a drug dealer and you know, gun-toting guy, played, by the way, by the veteran actor Mahershala Ali, who's in a lot of really cool miniseries and stuff. And he asks for help there. So there's all these different kind of shades and balances. You know, I really thought that this was a very solid movie done on a shoestring and done really well.
On a shoestring or a sneaker string?
Sure, that as well. Nicely done. Yeah, all kudos to Jordan Tipping and his cast, particularly Jaquin Guillory and obviously Mahershala Ali. And the guy who plays the thug, Kofi Cirabo, I've never seen him before. He's also scary. And then you see the human heart beneath the angry kind of thug when he confronts his child and has to deal with keeping the kid safe. So, yeah, you know, it's very well done stuff, I thought.
Author, the J.T. Leroy story.
Well, I actually have kind of a personal connection to this story because I know this writer named Laura Albert, who lives in the Russian Hill area where I am part of the time up in San Francisco. And this woman has been at the center of what is a literary storm since it was revealed that the author of a series of acclaimed fictional books and short stories was not the person he or she claimed to be. And that is at the heart of this documentary, Author of the J.T. Leroy Story, directed by a guy named Jeff Furzik. Now, Laura Albert had real experiences as a teenage runaway living in group homes and on the streets, and that's a lot of sordidness. You know, we're talking about teenage prostitution, drug use, the dissolute life on the road, all things that she sees while growing up. And she takes this stuff and writes books about it, but the books are presented as the work of one J.T. Leroy, who is, I guess we'd call that a pen name. She published under that name and also found the work embraced by critics and readers who assumed J.T. was a real person, and then she proceeded to continue that deception. Rather than reveal her real identity as the author at public appearances, Albert has her androgynous-looking sister-in-laws, Savannah Noops, put on a wig and sunglasses and play Leroy when the situation called for it. So the identity is eventually revealed, and she has all these celebrity fans, by the way, like Courtney Love and Winona Ryder and a bunch of like literary figures who embrace this wonderful, raw, gritty writing. By the way, always couched as fiction. It always says fiction on the books. So you have this person, you know, and she's basically hiding behind this name, and she continues the deception. But you could make a case that J.T. Leroy is part of the tradition of pen names that includes what? Samuel Clemens, a.k.a. Mark Twain. And more specifically, you remember George Eliot, who was, in fact, a 19th century female author named Mary Ann Evans. Regardless of that, this is like the celebrity-driven 15-second of news bite, 24-hour news cycle world of the 21st century, and people are screaming hoax. Anyway, this movie gives Albert a chance to tell her story through interview footage, journal entries, archival photos, and testimonials from her friends and allies and celebrity fans. I mean, it's a crazy story, and I think I have no problem with her doing this. I think if you look at it as a performance art piece or as some kind of avatar, there's no reason to vilify her. The stuff was always considered fiction as it was released, and you know everybody's had everybody's accepted the idea of pen names. So why is this different? You know, why are they making a big deal about this? That's my question, and that's the question asked by the movie as well.
For the Love of Spock.
For the Love of Spock is a very sweet, very personal documentary about Leonard Nimoy. And it's done by his son, Adam Nimoy, who is an actor and a director. and basically interviews with Nimoy, and of course he died fairly recently, and it's a terrible loss because he, by all accounts, and certainly by virtue of this movie, we see a pretty wonderful guy, and this is his life and his story, and also a lot about the creation and genesis, if you will, of Mr. Spock. And so a lot of people weigh in on this, and there are a lot of famous folks, many of whom are connected to Star Trek, which was the platform for the Mr. Spock character. By the way, we're looking at 50th anniversary right now of the beginning of the Star Trek franchise. Anyway, you get some terrific biographical stuff. You get Nimoy himself on camera. You get archival clips here. And you see in wonderful relief the relationship between the father and son, Leonard and Adam. And that's very, very sweet. I haven't seen anything this personal and this familial and this kind of accomplished in terms of filmmaking, but at the same time, almost like a home movie, because you do get so much with the two of them. And maybe there's not all that revealed, but it's a wonderful feature length experience and kind of a conversation with and about Nimoy. And I think it's kind of lovely. And you know, the personal relationship you have with your father isn't always going to be good. So, and the man's career had ups and downs, and all of that is in For the Love of Spock. I really enjoyed watching this immensely. I walked away from this thing with a smile on my face, and missing him as a presence in show business because of his passing as well.
And finally, Demon.
Well, Demon is a weird duck. Demon is a movie that was shot in Poland with a largely Polish cast, although the central figure is an Israeli actor, Polish.
Were they able to light the movie?
Oh, yeah. They actually had cameras.
They had Klieg lights, but were they able to actually put the bulbs into the Klieg lights?
Oh, yeah. They were able to figure it out. It's amazing.
Polish people on the set did it take to screw in the bulb into the Klieg light?
Well, I will say, honestly, David, as the credits ran,
Hang on. You don't get that, Alex?
No, I like it.
Oh, he doesn't get it.
No. On the credits was a light bulb wrangler, and there were 30 people there.
Very good. It's okay.
Anyway, Demon is a weird, kind of darkly funny and ultimately frustrating horror movie, and it's about this young guy of Polish descent who arrives from England where he lives, and he's in Poland to marry his Polish girlfriend, but they've only really known one another for a relatively brief time.
Did she chip her tooth on a vibrator? Is that the...
That's the wrong one.
Oh, okay.
He shows up, and the family is giving the couple their country house, which is in really terrible shape, and it's going to be a fixer-upper.
Because it's in the city. Because it's in the city. It's in Warsaw. Their country house is in Warsaw, because they're Polish.
Yeah, okay, we'll see how many of these you can come up with as we battle through this. Anyway, so it turns out this wedding that they're going to have, and they're going to have it at this kind of bombed-out-looking country house, is the wedding from hell. Because a demon from Jewish folklore, the Dybbuk, is unleashed on these people. And it begins possessing him, Peter, the guy who has come from London to marry Zenita. And they continue with the wedding while this guy is possessed. And there are some really outrageously good performances.
I'm sorry, are they Jewish?
Well, I think there's certainly... the Dybbuk is Jewish or was Jewish.
But are the Polish people, there are very few Jews left in Poland.
No, I don't think so. But the Jew intercedes, the Jewish spirit intercedes in the wedding. It's crazy. I mean, the guy starts like freaking out. It looks like some sort of epilepsy to everybody. So anyway, it still was kind of,
you know, when a Polish person has an epileptic seizure, they try to swallow somebody else's tongue.
Yeah, very nice.
I know, that
oh, anyway,
bad.
This is there's
that
a lot of absurd stuff goes on in this thing. It's funny, it's weird, but it just sort of left me dissatisfied. It was neither fish nor fowl, but, you know, nicely done. By the way, the writer-director, who is clearly talented, someone by the name of creator's name, Marcin Rona, died rather young. This is the last film from the director. And, you know, I see what's going on here, and there's a lot of skill and talent involved. It's just a very weird movie that's not going to be everyone's taste, and there are subtitles. Yeah. Yes.
You know how he died?
I'm really not sure, no.
He had a submarine with a screen door.
Okay. Well, that was your last gasp, I guess.
Hey, this was fun.
Well, yeah, why? Well, you forget how much fun we have when we do these things?
Yeah. It was fun.
Man.
All right. We'll talk next week, okay?
Well, certainly. Whenever you want to get together, just give a little holler. I'm Michael Snyder. You can check out my Twitter account, at Culture Blaster, if you want. You can go to Michael Snyder's Culture Blast on Facebook and like that page, or just tune in with David Feldman, and we'll knock your socks off with more film and culture stuff.
How's the great Alex Bennett doing?
He's fine. He's good. We do something for Roku, and you know, we are in contact pretty frequently. I'm sure he'd love a call, or he'd hate a call, depending on his mood.
Well, I wanted him to do the show with Slayton, and he wouldn't come by and do it.
Wow. Well, you know, here's something you got to remember about Alex. He's Alex Bennett, dude.
Yeah. Tell him to, yeah, he's mad at me because I've been in New York and we haven't gotten together.
If you'd only gone for a nosh with him, a nice corned beef, what the hell?
I'm here to social climb. And I explained that to him.
By the way, if I may, and this is not for your listeners or whatever, but oh my God, the work you've been doing with Smigel during the campaign is some of the best stuff I think you've ever done.
I agree.
And,
I agree.
And I brilliant. And here's another little note. At least a third of the sketches on Maya and Marty were very good. I assume you wrote them.
I will, as a creature of show business, I take credit for anything that's great. Even if I didn't even work on the show, I will take credit.
No. I know you work with Martin Short. Some of that stuff worked, but you know, and some of that stuff didn't. But that's the SNL sketch comedy TV show curse. You're going to have a couple hits, and you're going to have some misses.
Yes, and I've been misses you, missing. Oh boy.
Yeah. Okay.
It's been enough. It's been a long life. I think that's it. Michael Snyder is our resident film critic. We'll talk to you next week. Thank you, sir.
You bet.
I'm going to tell you about a podcast that I listen to. Two of my friends host it, and I think you should listen to it. Andrew Goldstein, maybe you remember him as my Jew on some of our more popular episodes of the David Feldman Show. Andrew Goldstein is a brilliant comedy writer from MTV and Race Wars. And Matt Goldich writes for Late Night with Seth Meyers, brilliantly funny comedian and comedy writer. They have a new podcast. You can download it on iTunes. It's called Sorry, I've Been So Busy. You know, everyone always says they're so busy, but what exactly are they so busy with? Well, in their podcast, Sorry I've Been So Busy, writer-comedians Matt Goldich and Andrew Goldstein talk to their interesting and funny friends to find out what they've actually been so busy with. Everything from major life and career events to everyday minutiae. Sorry, I've Been So Busy is the only podcast that will never blow you off unless something comes up.